Howdy. Fix that. There should be less echo now. Yeah. What's happening is I don't have headphones. So these are playing on my speaker. You probably realize this, but the music is playing on my speakers and the mic is picking it up. I have literally no way of listening to. We did this fine last time. I'm gonna listen to the stream to make sure it sounds passable, or at least as good or bad as it did last time. Let's see. Oh yeah, that's pretty bad. I don't have any earbuds. Alright, is this passable? I can't tell. I guess it's all fine. Well, you know what? I will do a couple of things. These guys can probably deal, you know, they live up to 5 Gs or so, so let's increase their G-force tolerance, because presumably the astronauts could have grown up in the higher gravity areas. That all looks very nice. Let's go. Alright, just to be sure, are the levels of the audio okay? Like, regardless of the of whatever echo there might be. Can you hear me okay? Oh yeah, for sure, Mesbin's not an easy homeworld. It's actually easier in the early game in some ways, but, well, you know, let's take a look into space. Alright, thanks, Cobalt. Here's our dear homeworld, Mesbin. The trouble you see is, this whole thing right here, that's about the size of the Mun, just for a bit of scale, which means from equator to equator, that's, you're looking at about 4 Kerbins. Pole to pole, it's about 2. So this is a pretty beefy, chunky planet to be sure. At the poles, we get 13 Gs. However, as you may be able to tell, Mesbin's really booking it. Really rotates at quite a hefty pace indeed. So at the equator, where you're further from the center of mass and you have a lot of centrifugal forces affecting you, the surface gravity is more like 1.3 Gs. It's a little bit less than 1.3 Gs. And that makes it possible to launch from. In addition, as we will see soon, you get a really huge boost to your orbital velocity just from the get-go. So let's go ahead and get these little contracts out of the way first. So one of the dealios on Mesbin is that it doesn't have any atmosphere, because KSP doesn't support spherical atmospheres. But that alone does make something pretty interesting happen. Which means, I mean, it causes for some interesting gameplay. Like, you can't land safely with parachutes, which means basically the engineers on Mesbin had to come up with a better solution for the first launch, and here we have it. You can see here's a 1.25 meter end plate for scale. This is the Kaputnik Mark Zero electromechanical program executor and 4 function integrated advanced calculator. Basically, it's actually a pretty powerful probe core, but it has no transmitter. All it can do is point in the 4 directions, prograde, retrograde, radial in and out, and normal and anti-normal. And it can control the throttle between 100 and 0%, and it can stage, and that's all it can do. It cannot do anything else. Unless you put an antenna on, and then it becomes a fully functional probe core. The trouble then is just that it's still utterly massive. It's I believe it's the most massive probe core in the game. That's weird. This shouldn't be any KSP music. I'm hearing KSP music. That's weird. Should not be any KSP music going on. Anyway, no point in putting science that we can't transmit. We're just gonna... It's not pro bo bo bo, it's pro bo do 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 bo dine. Okay, let me see, where is this music? Okay, I guess just sometimes you get glitchy music, that's inexplicable. Yeah, I think that's fine. Alright, so we can turn on the SAS, that's good. So you can see that we're starting out with 8.7 kilometers per second velocity, just from the get-go. This does not quite put us into space. Or it does not quite put us into orbit. Of course, just jumping on Mesbin technically puts you into space. And I say technically, but Mesbin does have to have an atmosphere, or exosphere as I call it, that goes up above the KSC. So I put it at exactly 970,000 kilometers, or 1,000 meters, because 970 is easy to remember, and it's just a couple kilometers above the KSC. So this should easily make do. This is what our trajectory ends up with. As you can see, we do have a periapsis that's above the polar radius. So it is recording the value of our periapsis, but that is not really useful because we will end up falling back to the ground. Alright, so let's just let this thing fall back. Nice midday. All right. This is Fortnite 1. We're 5 minutes into the game. Fortnite, by the way, is 14 nights. That is 14 rotations of Mesbin. Which means... which is about 6 hours. It's a little over 6 hours. So if you have 6 hours... in a fortnight, you end up with about approximately 1 second per second. Let's orbit Mesbin and gather some science. Now we do have some science to use. We'll get this tech node and that tech node, and we can also go ahead and get we'll go ahead and get that as well. So now we have a probe core that is capable of using an antenna. So we can give a direct control, but it doesn't know how to pilot itself. It's just, I guess, a very simple relay for command inputs. Okay, that's a little bit silly. That's an awful lot of Delta V. Hold on a minute. I don't accidentally still have Smurf installed, do I? Okay, so actually, it occurs to me that once we get around to, like, putting batteries and some science on the probe, we are going to get a little less Delta V out of the vehicle. No reason not to extend the antenna, after all, we are in a vacuum. But yeah, that still has more than enough to get into orbit, assuming this is calculated correctly. Actually, okay, I'm just super skeptical of that number. That just doesn't look right. What? That is very strange. I don't have any mods installed that should be messing with the mass ratios. But the mass ratios certainly don't look right to me. What? Okay, let me take a look at the wiki. FLT-800 fuel tank. It has a mass of 0.5 tons dry. Let's go ahead and give this a name. .5 tons full, 0.5 tons dry. Yep, that's... Alright, I guess that's... Well, okay. I guess in the past I've only ever used the Kaputnik as a first satellite, so we don't even need... I bet you... Hold on, let's see. Yeah, we'll do this. That'll be perfect. So there is a gimbal on this because restock, and I am gonna enable the yellow texture. Alright, so you may be looking at this massive planet with 13 G's of gravity and four Kerbins across and thinking, I don't know about that, Greg. I think you're full of shit. This thing ain't gonna make orbit. And, well, golly, I sure do hope it does. Well, it didn't quite make orbit, okay. Probably because all of that running back and forth. Let's hope that maybe if I get the decoupler off, it will accelerate us to orbit. I'm willing to doubt it, but it's not reporting that we're in orbit because we're not above the atmosphere. I mean, we're not, our periapsis is not above the atmosphere. Oh, this right here is Statmon. And oh look, there's Jemima, which just rose. Alright, looks like we're about at apoapsis. Yeah, that was basically nothing. Let's see. Nope. This is gonna fall back down. But we can at least take science from it. Oh, here's Durban. It looks awfully small, but it's just really far away. That thing is twice the size of Kerbin. So, I mean, in terms of science, that was for sure a successful mission. So the problem wasn't really a lack of delta V. I mean, it was a little bit that. Like, if we had a little more delta V, we probably might have made orbit. But the problem was mainly that we didn't have a way of circularizing. And luckily, rocket engineers have been experimenting with ways to get around that problem for months, maybe even years. I don't know. And they have made model rockets with really good thrust. So we're gonna give that a go now. We'll make this one orange because we can. That's a thing we're allowed to do. This is not actually a really good time to launch because the sun's going down. Okay, so that was a little less successful because of the mass of the separatrons, but hopefully the thrust of the separatrons will make up for it. So we burned a little bit too far downwards. We aren't gonna crash, but our apoapsis, that's a really good, okay, alright, we are gonna crash though. That's, I mean, are we, can we, you know, if we can't see the terrain, is it even really there? Yes, it is. I mentioned that was Stat Moon earlier, and given that it's not really moving, you might be able to tell why. Alright, here's my new plan. Thank you. Alright, I don't know how successful this is gonna be, but it'll be worth a go. Alright, let's make sure we got this burning rank. Use fire. Okay. I would call that unsuccessful. What if we just make these angled a bit? Really, they only need to be angled a bit. That way when we burn them, hopefully it'll stabilize the angle, so instead of falling back down, it'll keep burning forward. Oh, shoot, that's actually whatever. Okay, let's go. Hey, that's above the atmosphere. It's probably not above, like, the highest mountain, but it's above the atmosphere, and that's what counts. Yes, indeed! Okay, so, yeah, it is worth noting that a satellite that's spinning wildly like that is a slightly less useful satellite. And also, it's gonna stop spinning when I time warp for real. Let's see. Those first milestones. We've entered orbit. Yes, we have. Let's do the science experiment. Log temperature. Log atmosphere pressure. Yeah, we just needed to make sure. You know, you gotta repeat things in space, in science. You know. It's weird. I wonder. I wonder why that's not working. Oh. That's unfortunate. Okay, whatever. We're going to... Here's the idea. Actually, we'll use this one as 12 meters per second, we'll use this pod, because it has better impact resistance by quite a lot, in fact. Alright, it's time for the very first flight with an astronaut. We'll let Jeb do that. Valentina can go to space for the first time instead. that was fine. All of these haul booster into flight above Mesa, they're trash. I think I should figure out if I can remove these test in flight contracts entirely, because most of the altitudes that they'll ask you to use will be completely inaccessible unless you go to extreme lengths, and frankly they just don't return enough prestige and money for that. Obviously, you'd still get them if you're playing on curb mud. Okay, so this has a thrust of 125, this has a thrust of 192, this has 142, this one has 160. This one should burn longer. So maybe you can get into orbit. In fact, let's see what the TWR, 4.8, that's, we can reduce that quite easily. Maybe this one will be an orbiter. Let's get some mystery goo out of the deal, huh? Oh, hey, snails. How's it going, snails? Thank you. So this is gonna, we're gonna use this to get a contract completed and get Mystery Goo from Mesbin Orbit, and hopefully Mystery Goo from high over Mesbin as well. PWS too low, let's go back. I hate warm, though AD is not that bad. Well, golly, I do sure hope actually that you're talking about 80 Fahrenheit. Let's not go all doomsday. I know Dorian can be a bit doomsday for some, but 80 Celsius does seem a bit much, don't you think? Alright, oh! There's no gimbal on this thing. Okay, alright. What we'll do is we'll just try to get to high space somehow. This is not gonna work. It's really not. Okay, that's very interesting information, thank you. Oh, crap, I forgot to transmit the data. That was very silly, dumb even, of me. Oh, that wasn't even the right booster, damn it! Testing this tiny one instead. It's just only do this one. Yeah, and yet still one of the smaller yeets of the space program so far. Okay, let's see. We still gotta do a return to Mesbin from orbit. So these return about the same amount. We'll finish. We'll do the Explore Mesbin contract first. Then I can knock out two at a time with that. Escape contract. That's actually not enough thrust. That's a bit. Alright, we'll do what we did yesterday. Except with a Valiant instead of a Pug. Whatever, they can intersect the rocket if they want to. Right, so that'll be plenty enough to land, and then we just need to, like, launch the thing. This time we'll also run and return some mystery goo. Oh, this is not the mallet puncher. This is the, this is the hammerhead rocket. I'm an idiot. I didn't have full. That's slightly too heavy. God. Okay. still slightly too much. I think that should be okay. Yeah, it's gonna impact. It's gonna impact the sky at high speeds. Hopefully, it'll impact the ground at low speeds. Delta V don't look super good, actually. We can also do a little bit more space. Casting that light, you may ask? Jemima. Although Durbin would be pretty bright too. It's just that I can't make Durbin a star. Well, I shouldn't make Durbin a star. I could if I wanted to. It's my own damn mod. Real dim, never mind. Maybe I should increase the lighting from Jemima just to make it look cooler. Not even close to. I want to complete one full revolution around Mesbin, but that's going to take several sidereal orbits because, relative to Mesbin, we're not moving all that fast. We're moving at 10 kilometers per second orbital velocity, Our surface velocity is only 1.5. Alright, I don't think we're at any risk of running into the planet, so I'm just gonna go berserk with the time warp. Alright, there we go, real fast. Coming up over the KSC at night, of course. Let's see if there's any way to spot it. There it is. Oh no, that's that one. But that is... that does mean we're pretty close to KSC. It may not be nighttime for... no, it'll be nighttime for KSC. So... look out for the glowy buildings, I guess. Yep, there it is. Okay. Let's see if I can zoom in and get a good picture. Revolution around Mesbin. Is gonna be close, I think. I didn't think it would be that close. Hold on. See, the point of the Cub is that it is a steering rocket, and that's why I added it. With just a handful of man, we'll start all over again.
But if mankind is to survive, the people left alone.
We're gonna crash. We now have less delta V than our velocity. This is bad! Oh no! Come on. Oh! There's a chance! No. Are those science containers? Nope, they're engines. Oh, it is an engine. And two girders. That's not enough. If it was the science, if we recovered the science, I would have let Jeb die. Science is what we're all about here. Thank you.
mankind is to survive, but people left alone.
Alright, let's go ahead and burn a little bit forward and up just to hope that we miss that mountain. And we can get a little closer to the ground. Oh, that was our periapsis ship. We're good. That's a hefty sum of science. Alright. We can't quite get one of these, but if we choose one now, I can go get some launch pad and runway science, and we'll have enough. That gets us cryogenic engines, which are a little less necessary now that we're not playing at RSS scale. Struts aren't really that important because I've got KJR, Kerbal Joint Reinforcement. Rover's not really going to need those. Let's see. Flight control gets us a nice RCS tank and some reaction wheels. Basic science gets us... Okay. That relay might be really useful, actually. Relay and the better science. Alright, we'll go for, we'll go for basic science. Alright, so, that's not right. I don't care. We're gonna just... There. I traded 10 science for 1,000 funds. Fine. It's fine. I don't care. I don't want to... Because you know I could easily get 10 science from Launchpad and Runway. I'll just make sure that I don't ever get that science. It'll be fine. There we go. Let's send a probe somewhere. Let's send a probe. Ooh. Let's send a probe to Greymon. 17 kilometers per second versus 23.
Oh, right.
That's a good delta V. That'll get us to Curbmon just about. Problem though, we are at 27 parts, so hopefully I can launch this thing into orbit with only... Actually, that might be feasible. Alright, so we're over the mass limit, but I'm just gonna upgrade the launch pad. Choosing the barometer. Mesmin scientists do not necessarily know what the atmosphere in the space around Curbmon is like. Perhaps there's quite a bit of atmosphere surrounding Curbmon, or perhaps there's none. Perhaps there's none. But the only way to find out would be to take a barometer. the thermometer, you could in principle measure Curbmon's temperature from the surface. The barometer is a lot air pressure is a lot harder to measure indirectly. So we'll bring the barometer. If I had one more part, I would bring a cavern goo containment unit, but I don't. Although I could make, if I sacrificed a battery, nice. No way around the asymmetry, I guess. Okay, I think that'll do it. Say yes. So the idea is we get a idea of material science in high Mesmin orbit, in high Curbmon orbit, and in low Curbmon orbit, or Curbmon space. We're not actually going to enter orbit. I'm an idiot. Okay, I need to relaunch this. I wasn't paying close enough attention. So the idea is we're going to do high Mesmin orbit, high Curbmon space, low Curbmon space, and as a stretch goal for the mission, we're going to see if we can successfully enter the atmosphere and return some barometer science. There's our target right over there. Yeah, we're pretty much in orbit. Thank you. So we'll need to burn towards Kerbmon. We don't have any maneuver notes, so we'll just do the good old burn at moonrise trick. There it is. Well, see, the thing is that it actually does pretty well approximate what you need to do for any given moon. I mean, unless it's too close. Because, basically, if you're rendezvousing with an object that's, like, out to infinity, say, you're pretty much gonna burn directly prograde when you're facing the target. So when prograde and your target align, that's when you burn forward. When you burn prograde to reach an object that is arbitrarily far away. When it's closer, I think is a little bit more complicated than that. But that's roughly where you get like phase angles and stuff from. A little bit worried we're not going to make it. Yeah, okay, that wasn't enough. Alright, we'll have to squeeze out a little more Delta V out of this thing. Gets us quite a bit of extra. Hello, Kerbaling Smasher. I'm doing all right. That undoes a fair bit of the aerodynamic protection. So that if we enter the atmosphere, it'll be engine first, and the probe core will be relatively protected. We still need a little more Delta V than that, though. Right, alright, let's... We'll get rid of the mystery goo for now. And now this can be, 4 boosters. Mesben arriving at Kerbland. Yeah, we need at least like 3,900 meters per second of Delta V in orbit to be safe. Engine will reduce our Delta V because it's a higher mass engine, but yeah, okay, that's just, that reduces it too much. But this one that has higher ISP, yeah, this is the only engine to use from a Delta V standpoint. If I could get a second engine, though, it would help a lot. What about the pug? That has more thrust. It's not as efficient though. I'm gonna test this on the pad to see how much battery those materials bays use. Now the Terrier would be great. I'm using the pug though. Which the Terrier has higher ISP and a higher thrust, which means if I had it unlocked, it would be perfect for my purposes. Oh my god. That. Oh no! Is not enough. There's not enough electric charge. There's barely enough to run a single experiment. Oh. If I had a solar panel, and I don't, not for a while, and I won't for a while, that is, I would be able to recharge between experiments and it might work. Does mean we only need one material bay that unlocks use of two more parts, so I guess I'll put back on the mystery goo, the cavern goo. Oh, hey. I don't need as many boosters now. Thank you. which one's better here. 27k. Wait. We look that close, huh? 27, 12. Neither of these are enough. I don't know why I even bother. What about one of these? No, not enough. Yeah, pretty much we're still stuck with the pug. Charge, damn it. And we'll need some charge just to run the probe. Save the materials bay for later. My phone. No one important. And my phone's dead. Perfect. This one, at least. Oh, I don't like how that's... Thank you. Yep. Gotta have plenty of batteries. Let's test the science. Okay. All right. Yes, that'll work. Nope, this won't work. Can anyone guess why this won't work? There's no gimbal. About a gimbal again. Not enough delta V. This only gimbals. It doesn't gimbal enough for what I need. We did have a bit of an excess of batteries, it looked like, so, What? Pug's not supposed to have a gimbal. Let me just tweak the RCS to get a little more efficiency out of it. If you only have one set of RCS blocks, and you want balanced translational thrust, then you have to put it towards the center mass. However, it's not really possible to get rotation from a single thruster on each block. So we have single linear thrusters. You want to get that as far away from the center of mass as possible. That maximizes the torque. But it also maximizes the translation you get. Ooh. That wasn't as much Delta V as I expected. Oh, only 1071 meters per second. That's... Oh, 12. Okay, it's still way less than I thought it should be. So, to be clear, I still... Wait, no. Okay, this should do it. So we still have 4159 meters per second. That doesn't look really great, I'll be honest. That. I betcha, actually, maybe if we wait and orbit around and keep burning. So close. Okay. So that is just barely touching the orbit. And thank goodness, I just remembered Kerbman has quite a bit of tilt, but we managed to catch it while it was passing through, or such that we will be passing through the equatorial plane at the same point that Kerbman does. Came in way too early, but it's fine because we have a little more fuel. Space, even though we do not have an atmospheric intersection, which is what we wanted. space near curb mud. Perfect. How's about that? Alright, we need the barometer. Good. And we'll log the temperature. Barely managed it. Okay. And we'll take some pictures. Get a little bit of the far side of curb mud, never before seen. Into hibernation in the hopes that sometime in the next few orbits it will intersect curb mud. Looking like another intersect. Okay, that is in fact another intersect. What's that do for us though? There's curb mud. There it is. So this is a unique view of curb mud from the perspective of these of the Mesbanites. Never before seen view of the far side. that's pretty close to just a normal view, though we get a little bit of the other side of the far side, which we didn't get before. And, oh, okay, alright, we just flew by. Man, we barely missed it this time. Okay, so it looks like intercepts are going to be less common. Although, maybe we intersected again here. Yes, we do. But just another South Polar intercept. Coming right over the South Pole this time, though. Possible to get another intercept, or very, very unlikely to get another intercept. Well, nope. That looked like it's about as close as it's ever gonna get. So we're almost out of power. Now, so that we don't have to deal with those batteries anymore, let's see, just make sure that there's nothing here that I really want. Yeah, not really. We'll go ahead and get the solar panel. Well, last time I did a Whirligig World career stream, not including Whirly Big World, which was yesterday, I ended on a Curb Mun probe, and I think I'll do the same today. I'd like to continue this. Maybe I will tomorrow, maybe some other day, but you know, I've been Greg Roxman, and I'll see y'all later. Actually, hold on a minute. There we go. See y'all later.